Scripture says it. There's a time for every purpose under heaven. Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1. Look at your neighbor and say, don't become weary in well doing. For in due season you'll reap if you faint not. Amen. Galatians 6 and 9. Somebody say due season. A woman don't get pregnant one day and then the next day say, oh, I ain't got as much trouble giving this example as I used to. I'm going to let you stay somewhere. Hey, Lord. Before she reminds you, you made her that way. Put a frying pan upside the head. She don't get pregnant today and have the baby tomorrow. A farmer don't walk out door to God in his field that's freshly tilled to drop a seed in it and say, oh, I'm expecting a harvest. Get up early the next morning and run out. I quit.
Come on.
No, he don't go in the towel and quit. My God, he goes. Amen. He thinks about it as time goes on. Come on, somebody. He fertilizes it. He waters it. He irrigates it. Come on. Amen. In over space of time, there comes a season when that that was planted and took care of, amen, is harvested. Glory to God. Friend, if God has taught you something, that's the seed of his word. Fertilize it with your faith. And anyhow, that means to me, that gives me hope. Because that simply means that God says it's got a time. Somebody shout, there is a cutoff time. And God says, okay, enough is enough. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings as an eagle, they'll run and not be weary, they'll walk and not faint. Isaiah 40, verse 31. This word wait in Scripture there simply means I'll hope. And the word wait gives us the example of a waiter in a restaurant waiting on customers, taking their orders. Waiting. Not sitting around. Twiddling thumbs. Waiting is like a waiter serving. They that keep serving the Lord. Those that keep coming to his house. Those that keep giving. Those that keep praying. Those that keep believing. Those that keep fasting. Those that keep standing on his word. Those that don't give up. Amen. Glory to God. But mount up in faith. They that wait. They keep serving him in faith. They shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like an eagle. An eagle don't sit on top of the mountain or peak of a limb, or the top of a limb and the peak of a mountain, even though that praise God. No, an eagle sits there, and an eagle could be a buzzard, be a vulture. You notice they don't do it on flight. They may at first, but they're gliders. They're soarers. They go with the wind, but James is going with the wind. They go to the out. They don't do a lot of flapping. That's why we got a lot of church folks acting like chickens. Chickens can't fly. They may look like they can for a moment just to get over the fence or over some predator or something, but they can't fly. They can't stay up there long. Come on, somebody. That's why we got in a lot of modern Christians, because people ain't willing to wait on God. Ain't willing to wait on him in a church service because, oh, God ain't nothing happening, so I got to make something happen. So let's start flapping everybody. Let's hurry. Time's running out. Come on, people. It's going to warm leads. Oh, cluck, cluck, cluck. wings like an eagle, you got to learn to wait.
Oh, yeah.
That's why I don't get in a hurry when I come to church. I've had people say, why don't you sing so much like tonight? Because I sang until I heard him say stop.
Yeah.
Some nights it may just be one or two or three. Most out of three. Please. But now I don't know how many I sang. The Holy Ghost said, just keep singing. Every night, I was going to stop. My voice was wearing out. I was hollering, sweating, glory to God. Amen. Amen. Some of that singing I was doing, it felt like it was coming from another world. Amen. Glory to God. But I was still feeling it in my body. It was a few times, glory to God, I was seeing little dots. Lord, have mercy. Praise God. I was my oxygen up there. I needed it to be. Come on, somebody. That's some of that late night preaching. Even. Getting in the way. But I heard him say, keep saying. Say until I tell you to preach. Somebody said, wait. Friend, if we're unwilling to wait, the Bible tells us in 1 Samuel 14 that Saul, his downfall. King Saul, the anointed of the Lord. We think it started in 1 Samuel 15 when he disobeyed the voice of God the second time. But the first time he disobeyed God, and when God prophesied through Samuel the prophet that I'm going to take his kingdom from him, was when, listen, Samuel said, I'll be back in 7 days and I'll offer a burnt offering before the Lord. No, don't do a thing until I get back. But he couldn't wait. This is 1 Samuel, I believe, 13. Beginning somewhere probably verse 7, around verses 12. Saul admitted that he forced himself. Saul was not no priest. He didn't have no business offering a sacrifice of an offering to God in the old covenant. See, when you're unwilling to wait on God, you begin to do things you ain't called to do. Hello? You're trying to do things God ain't never anointed you to do. God anointed him to be king and to wait on the word of the Lord. And Samuel in this text represents the prophetic word of God. And the word was, I'll be back in 7 days. Well, here's what Saul's problem was. The Philistines, the enemies, amen, were encamping about him, getting closer in, and people were leaving him. His help was leaving him. Somebody says, scary times. His support's leaving, and his enemies getting closer. So he said, I better give me a burnt offering and give it up to the Lord. These enemies going to kill us. People's leaving me. Oh, God, the church is going down. We didn't make the bells. It's important. And he forced himself to do something he wasn't called to do. And when Samuel got back at the last hour of the seventh day, God likes that last minute thing. Showed up, and Samuel rebuked him. And Saul was saying, well, I forced myself. Look at your neighbor saying, waiting on God requires faith in God. But wait is never no, it's a delayed yes. Wait is never no. So if God ain't showed up and it's the last day, my friend, wait, he'll show up if it is the last second of the last day. But wait, don't get weary in the waiting, because nowhere do I find God saying, let the force be with you. Makes the heart sick, but when a desire comes, it's like a tree of life. Proverbs 13:12. Hope that is lost. It's what deferred means. Somebody say, hope lost is depression found every day. But when your hope is not a thing but a person, 1 Timothy 1:1, Jesus the Lord, not hope. When your hope is in a person, not a thing. Not a nation, not a limited person that's flesh, but in the living God himself, it's hard to lose it. Jeremiah 17:17. God, you are my hope on a day that's evil. And we're in evil days. 2 Timothy 3 talks about fierceness. People will be fierce come. No remorse after murdering people. Heard one the other day that killed somebody and cursed the judge out. They're fierce. Terrorist groups taking people's heads off. Fierce. Barbaric. But fulfilling scripture. Right from Revelation. Second Timothy 3:1 said, in the latter times, the last days will be perilous times, troubled times, evil times. Here's the reason for the evil. Men, verse 2, shall be lovers of themselves. Every other sinful, evil, wicked deed mentioned thereafter is because of that. Why is all evil happening in the world, preacher? God so holy and great, why don't he stop it? God didn't create robots. God didn't put little antennas on top of Adam and Eve and then hold the remote control and say, no, I didn't say go that way. Or a shop car. Then he would be forcing instead of by faith. Because faith in God's a choice. Say that with me. Faith in God's a choice. The Bible said in Hebrews 11:24, by faith, Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Verse 25, choosing, somebody say choosing, to suffer the afflictions with the people of God and enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. So his faith in God refused the world and what the world said he was, and his faith chose to either suffer and follow God and his people. Faith in God's always a chance. That preacher, I just lost my faith. You ever lost God? You ain't no more lost it.
Yeah, never have.
1 Timothy 1, verses 19 said, holding faith in a good conscience, which some have put away concerning faith that are made shipwreck. Two things there, holding faith or putting away faith. Meaning faith in God's a choice. I either choose to believe him or I choose to put it away and not believe. Whoa. Don't lose faith, you choose faith. What's your choice going to be? God's not the author of evil. He made man upright, but man sought out his own inventions, wanted to do it his way. It's still God's. Ecclesiastes 7:29. And that's why evil is in this earth. Period. Hello? Even Romans 8 said the earth groans because of the sin and the wickedness. The earth is opening up. Hello? Storms coming down. I know the insurance company calls it acts of God, but it ain't no act of God. It's the earth groaning and moaning over this sin. Sin don't just affect people, it affects this earth. That's why 1 Peter 5 said when he comes the second time, he's going to purge it and purify it with fire. No flood. Well, preacher, I thought God said there'd never be another flood. That's what you get for thinking instead of reading the Bible yourself. In Genesis chapter 8 and 9, the Bible didn't say that God said there'd never be a flood on the earth. No, he said, I'm going to put a bow up in the heavens. We call it a rainbow. To give a covenant, and this will be my covenant with mankind. I'll never flood the entirety of the earth again. There's never been a flood, amen, since Noah's flood that covered the whole earth. God didn't ever say there wouldn't be a flood on the earth. He just said the flood wouldn't cover the entirety of the earth. Glory to God. So, amen, but the second time, according to 1 Peter 5, it's going to be with a fire. But I won't be here. I'll come back after it's purged. When he comes, when all the armies are dead, all on white horses, Revelation 19, read it to me. Hope in an evil day. It's a Somebody shout, hope is Jesus. Holy Ghost, I thank you for a hope tonight that's beyond our comprehension. For the God of all hope filled you with joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Romans 15:13. Somebody say, abounding in hope. Meaning God will overrun and supply hope. Look at your neighbor and say, need some hope, it's right over here. Thanks.
Yeah.
Does it just brush upon me? I'm Brother Hope, Sister Hope.
I'm Brother Hope.
We just go home.
Yeah.
Hope.
Yeah.
Hope. Oh, some hope. He literally said tonight, he left and I stepped on his toes. Hallelujah. Hope that's King Chino. Hallelujah. But listen. He said, abounding in hope. Someone says, through the power of the Holy Ghost. You don't get hope from a pill, from a doctor. You don't get hope, come on, somebody, from some sexual relationship with somebody you've never met. You don't get hope, Lord of God, from a dark bottle. You don't get hope from nothing else. Hope only is found in Jesus. He's the God of all hope. He said, I'll fill you with joy and peace. Here's the condition. In believing. As long as you believe, I feel you. Got any believers here tonight? Maybe you're sitting here and you say, well, preacher, I do believe. I believe in, but I'm not really sure I've believed on. Is there a difference? Psalm 119. Excuse me. Thank you, Lord. Book of Acts 16:31 says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be saved here in your house. James 2:19 said, devils believe in God and tremble. I tell people that tell me they believe in Jesus, I tell them, brother, you got the same level of faith as me. I don't believe in that chair. If you say no, I got to pull it out. It's right there. Look at your neighbor and say, I believe in it. I believe in it. Here's how I believe on it. That's how I believe on it. What I can stand over at a distance and look at and say I can believe in don't support me, don't help me one bit until I walk and get close to it and actually sit down on it. You can stand at a distance and say, I believe in Jesus, and still die and go to hell. The saints got that same kind of thing. Devils don't do what I just did, saying that chair was Jesus. They stand over here and say, oh, I believe in God, I believe in God. They don't even tremble, James 2:19 said. God says, after you believe in and you tremble, then you must do something about what you believe in. You must come to me. And you must cast your life on me, repent of your sin, and believe what I did on the cross for you. That's believing. That's why we've got a lot of people that are believers and sitting in church, but still on their way to hell. Hell's full of believers. I believe in Jesus. They're still the same person they've always been because they've never really trusted in Jesus. They've never believed in him. So now I ask you that question while I'm in this room. I done preach beyond the audio, he couldn't handle it. I run out of time to make videos through it. Let me tell you, whether it was being captured this moment or not, it's being recorded in heaven right now. I feel right around in my spirit, God's about to record somebody's name. Lamb's prayer. Revelation 20:15, whosoever's name was not written in the book of life was cast into the living fire. Your name can be on the roll down here, but if it ain't on the roll of calendar, my friend, when Jesus comes or you die, you won't go. Good old boys and good old gals occupy hell right now. Good ain't good enough. You must be born again, John 3:3. Maybe you believe in him, it's time to believe on him.
Thank you.